coming with a mask on. Coming for the lock, coming for the jackpot. Three white lines in a bunker. I be in a cloak, trying to kick it like Lampard. That's where I might make a bad. What can I say? I'm a born sinner. 155 in an all black dinger. Cops don't want it. Smoke that chronic. Not one drug that that boy's not shotting. Two birds in the back of the whip. Sucking dick from the woman that sniff without check. When I pull up and I'm taking your bitch, I'm not sick. Be thinking that I'm taking the pitch, a little div. I'ma pull up on that big 450. Pop it and twist it. Watch when it kicks it. Cops are resisting. Boys are resisting. Drop it and lift it. Course I'm a misfit. Red light, risk it. Bitch, I'm a chava. Big goose Parker. All black clava. All black towel. Come in with a mask on. Come in for the lock. Come in for the jackpot. I'ma pull up on that big 450. Pop it and twist it.
Watch. Sorry. Cops are resisting. Some of my settings got changed. Lift it. Course I'm a misfit. Red light, risk it. Bitch, I'm a chava. Big goose Parker. All black clava. All black towel. Come in with a mask on. Come in for the lock. Come in for the jackpot. My bad, everyone. Some settings got changed. I was playing music the whole time. I was listening to it, but the setting was wrong. I think I reset some shit and it broke some shit. Not mean. Now what's a mean? Hey, everybody, I'm back. What's up, everybody? I'm Will Neff. It's Saturday. After a night off, I'm back. Let me fix some shit. All right, that's better. What's up, everybody? A very hearty. Hey now. Willard, you're impossible to get a hold of. Tried to call you this week. Bro, I'm a grown ass man. Let me live my fucking life. Sorry, bud. I'm doing my best to make time for everything. Will Smith apology, Vim?
Oh, yeah, wow. That's for a cooler.
Let's go.
Sorry if I'm a little stressed. Farley's been sick today. And I've been running doggy hospice, basically. Not hospice. He's okay, but he was just a little under the weather. He was a little freaked out because he was feeling sick. But he's better now. He's doing better. He's resting. Race the quest for Hockery. Thank you. Nam, I will be in touch. Don't worry. I've just been barely hanging on by the skin of my teeth. Have you seen the Iceman based on fossils? The Iceman? What is this? A movie from 2017?
Oh, yeah, wow. That's
for Zacharoni6495, thank you for the prime. At first, the man was believed to be a hiker. Yo, saw a G4 commercial for Arena on Sci-Fi? Oh, let's go. Well, we know how this story ends. This dude freezes to death. Am I reading the wrong, or does the title say Digimon? Yeah, a new Digimon game came out yesterday. And so I fully plan on Digimoning today. I don't give a shit who's not into it. I love Digimon, and I am gonna play the fuck out of some Digimon. I'm gonna play the shit out of some Digimon Survive. Are they ever going to let you host Attack of the Show? I mean, good question. Probably not. Monthly Kaka, that is all. Thank you, Bundle of Kiwi. If they haven't let me host yet, I don't think they're going to. Why not? Probably I'm a little unpredictable and I have a lot of trouble reading a prompter. Digimon, is that a Jamaican thing? I don't know. Could be. Big Sag, I think they will one day. I'm gonna keep it a buck. I'm okay not hosting. It's a lot of pressure.
Wanted to share the photo from TwitchCon.
Ooh.
It didn't work out as well as I wanted, Loiso. But thank you for inspiring. Trying to get back into film photography.
Oh, dude. That's a cool photo still. Hell yeah, baby. Hell yeah, baby. Guys, I've been losing weight again. I've been doing my 2 hours in the gym every day. Starting to finally take hold. Louie Smoothie, thank you for the prime. Digimon, yes. We're doing Digimon Survive today. And no, it's not a fucking ad. I just really like Digimon. I am just a Digimaster. I have enjoyed like every Digimon game. What I hear about this one is that it's fucking incredible. Is there a bounty? Nope, there's no bounty. I just like Digimon. Okay? I'm keeping it a buck. Will, why didn't you join Chad Vice? I make a lot of content for Hassan.
Oh yeah, wow. That's very cool.
Bobo Fabrice, thank you. It's my anniversary. Happy to support you. Thank you. Happy anniversary. I hope you're celebrating. Let's go, slags. Oh, you slags. We need to convince Canute to do Camp Canute 2 in LA. I mean, I don't think it'd be hard to convince him. I think he's digging that so many people are into Camp Canute. Camp Canute's great content. I'd love to have him out here. We could do me, Symphony, Courage, Ali, Hassan. We'd have a pretty good crew out here too. Bro, Symphony's been getting real big, bro. Slags, you know I'm celebrating. Hope to see another Kickstart My Heart shirt rip tonight. God can only hope. God can only hope. Just wondering, are you playing with Courage tonight for the 100 wins? I am supposed to be playing with Courage. I think I'm taking like the graveyard shift. I think I'm taking like 12 to 2. I'm going to hit him up at like 11:30 and see what's good. But I know he's trying to hit the 100 crowns, and I think I'm going to help him at some point. So, you know what it is. You're playing late night tonight? Oh, yeah. If I enjoy Digimon at half as much as I expect I'm going to enjoy it, I'm going to try and like play like at least like a fourth of the game. I know it's a super long game, but I'm going to do my best. Frankenstein 913, thank you so much. Gladiator is on Prime. Interesting. That might be a fun film to do. Digimon Survive. Yeah, that's the plan tonight. Bro, I don't know. Let me even check on the directory right now. Is anybody playing Digimon Survive? Bro, no one is playing Digimon Survive. What the fuck? Dude, it's just... At the top, it's just me. All right? You know what? I might be the last Digimon fan. I don't give a shit. I'll hold the line by my fucking self. Okay? I'll be the Digimon guy. Fuck everybody for sleeping on Digimon. All right? The game has like a 9 out of 10. You know in your heart of hearts, the last 3 Pokemon have kind of sucked. I love Pokemon. I do. All right? I love Pokemon. I do. But for real, on God, they've kind of sucked. Where the fuck is my Agumon?
Oh yeah, wow, that's very cool.
2 months. So glad to be here, Willard. I love this community so much.
I'll fucking hold the line.
Oh yeah, wow, that's very cool.
2 months less than three.
Burrito Dave, thank you. Thank you for the 2 months. Dono Wall. Did someone dono? 2 months, so glad to be here, Willard. I love this community so much. Thank you, King Bimmy. Are you a Bionicle enjoyer as well? I used to fuck with the Bionicles that you would build. Yes.
Oh, yeah, wow.
I was never a fan of, like, the show, but I like building them. Will Neff, best Neff? I mean, there's a Neff that plays Frisbee. Is pretty cool. I'm just trying to get cranked up here. Is it Willard or William? The world will never know. Could be Billy. Give me that shit. I'm gonna say it. I know I'm gonna piss some people off. I'm a Pepsi guy, right? Coke is Pokemon. Pepsi is Digimon. I'm a Pepsi guy. I prefer Digimon to Pokemon. Why? Their designs are better. Straight up. Nah, dude. Listen. Digimon, the final Digivolutions, they're sexy.
Actually, your worst take.
I saw a joke yesterday that, like, the final Digivolutions, you can catch them on Grindr, bro. They're all, like, jacked fucking alpha giga males. Like, someone had the Fresh Faces tab on Grindr open, and they were like, oh, whoops, and it was all Digivolutions. And I was like, I get it.
Oh, yeah, wow, that's very cool.
I mean, bro. Damn. Where are some good images of the Digivolutions? Hello? All these images suck. Okay, but here's a good example. Look at this guy! The only Pokemon that is this hard is Guzzlord. Yo, big ups to my Guzzlord. But, like, dude, they all have, like, fucking weapons and shit. They, like, look like monster Gundams. I mean, what? Huh? This cat evolves into fucking Charlize Theron? What is going on, man? Am I crazy? Or am I just the only one who's singing? Look at these evolutions! What the fuck? What the fuck? I mean, that shit is crazy. And Digimon follows the format, all right? This is a very important formatting thing that I've always said about starters. Okay? You start egg, then you go hyper cute, then there's kind of like a kitschy middle ground, and then there's like insane evolutions. Like, they're fucking batshit. And I fuck with that energy. Anyway, listen, I don't know. This game might suck. I'm gonna keep it a buck with you. I know nothing about this game other than that it's got insane reviews. And Digimon does this weird thing, right? Digimon does this weird thing where they don't follow the Pokemon format at all, right? Pokemon, I love it or hate it, and I love Pokemon. I love Pokemon. I play all the games, okay? I play Pokemon Go every day of my life. I love Pokemon. Let me say it. They've been making the same game for 30 years, okay? That's just facts. That's just church, right? They've been making the same game. They've never, dude, aside from like Pokemon Snap and what was the arena one? Pokemon. The one on Pokemon Coliseum. Yeah, Pokemon Stadium, sorry. Aside from Pokemon Stadium and Pokemon Snap, all the Pokemon are essentially the same game. Digimon does something totally different. Almost every single Digimon game has been completely different. They've been completely different games. Like the main core titles have been completely different genres, which is crazy to me. Digimon Survive, user score 1.2, overwhelming dislike. Based on 44 reviews, what the fuck is Gyazo? I mean, I don't know what the fuck Gyazo is. But Steam has it at overwhelmingly positive. And what's the other one? Do, 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 do. By the way, thank you for the hype train.
I'm a stud. I'm ballsy. I don't take no shit from anyone.
Digimon was a great show.
Oh, Metacritic has it really low too.
Digimon helped with furries and cat girl streamers.
Huh. Well, we'll give it a try. We'll give it a try. Steam seems to really like it. Some people hate it. I like Digimon enough to give it a try. You could try Temtem. Basically a better version of Pokemon Online. Temtem? What the fuck is a Temtem? What is this, Facebook's version of Pokemon? What the fuck is this? Is this the meta version of Pokemon? Collect creatures. Banoppy! Okay, that looks weird. Listen, I think for a long time, I could make the perfect monster game. I've played a lot of them. I think at this point, I can make the perfect monster game, all right? First step, okay? You start with Digimon 1, right? The original Digimon world, where you have like a gym and a town, and as you go out and catch monsters, they like build your town, right? So you like build a base in your game. Then I would put an app on the phone in association with the game. So you literally do Pokemon Go type shit, where it's like, if you want to get a rare Pokemon, they're like, or a rare whatever monster. It's like, what guess what? You shoot that monster is 10 miles away. You have an hour to get there, or like 2 hours to get there. And then you go do the fucking fight on your phone, like 2 hours away. Like you gotta go get it, right? And then the fights, you go Monster Rancher style, right? Where you like train up your monster to like fight for you, right? You're not directly controlling it. He puts his best foot forward and it's automated. That way, like your upbringing can directly affect like how much he can fight, right? Like his AI level. So you could have a monster that's like not as strong, but if he's like slick like Roy Jones Jr., he's dicing up whatever OP fucking piece of shit monster this guy hasn't raised up right. You know what I mean? You gotta have a trainer monster relationship, right? Bad game, no please. What? Monster Rancher? You're high, dude. You're high on that fucking... You're high... Dude, you must really like selecting, you know, quick attack over and over again. I'm gonna... Dude, Pokemon's fight system sucks. It is boring. That is why they have started to phase it out of their fucking games. Right? That is why they have started... The Pokemon fight system sucks so much that they are phasing it. It's the core element of the Pokemon franchise, and they're phasing it out of their own franchise. Why do you think they are replacing experience from battles with experience from catching shit? Because they know it's like the, it is like the most baby version of turn-based combat in the world. Like they don't even add strategic elements like, you know, landscape or positioning or anything like that. It's just select the move, rock, paper, scissors. Will is molding. No, I'm not. I'm just telling you the facts. There's a new Monster Rancher coming out? It's like baby chess. It's not like baby chess. It's like baby rock, paper, scissors.
Name card highlight of the whole Kantai.
And then I'm going to be honest. Pokemon broke their entire system when like every Pokemon could learn every move, bro. Like I have a fucking Rhydon with Earthquake and Surf. Huh? What? I can learn a move from every type? How does anybody counter that? If my Rhydon has a move that is ultra effective against the type that is ultra effective against him, how do you win? All right, let's check out this new Monster Rancher thing. What the fuck is this? Oh my god, they're doing music spawns again? Bro, it's literally like the throwback Monster Rancher. Oh, hell yeah. Oh my god, slideshow? What do you mean? Is my stream effing? Thank you. Combined them, daddy. Combined them. Oh!
Honey.
You're gonna need a bigger ranch. Fuck yeah, dude. Super, Salvador, thank you so much.
Yeah, wow, that's
Will, this looks so bad.
If any tease on what the next reality show might be since Alone is done?
No. I haven't really thought about that. I'm gonna be honest, I think I'm gonna start focusing on my YouTube more. I think I'm gonna do more like event type streams. I'm buying an IRL backpack, and I think I'm just gonna go do more stuff. Like plan bigger streams. What about Neopets? Yo, I was a Neopet fucking warlord. I had an item that was worth so many. Was it bells? Were bells the currency? I had like a wand that was worth like 100,000 bells or something. And I had like the flame paint job too on my monster. Sheesh. I really like monster trainer games, bro. I'm gonna keep it a buck. There is one game that is so fucking slept on when it comes to the monster training universe, and it's amazing to me. This game never got a re-release or like a like subsequent games on modern systems. Jade Cocoon was that business. Jade Cocoon was in the business of monster ranching, dude. Jade Cocoon was who played some Jade Cocoon? Wow, we don't have many Jade Cocooners here. This game was tight.
Wow, that's for a cool.
Hey Will, I love you. Keep it up, Tilda.
Thank you. Ancient memory unlocked. Dude, I love how I say it's the most slept on game and everybody's reaction is like, what is that obscure ass game? I told you, that shit is slept on. I mean, if I had said Pokemon Sapphire, y'all would have been like, huh. Burrito Dave, thank you. What is this? The Lost Wild?
One sub to their anaked.
Oh yeah, wow, that's for a cool.
Burrito underscore Dave underscore gifted a tier one sub to Baba Ganoush.
Oh? Have you seen the Ultraman TV show? No. I know who Ultraman is, but no, I never. Ultraman is so popular. Not in the United States. I'm gonna be honest. I think a lot of people would know who he is in like the hyper nerd sphere, but I don't think like anyone I know has watched Ultraman. Yeah, what is this? Oh, flare time. The Lost Wild. Interesting. Can I fuck with it? Could be cool. Listen.
I'm a stud. I'm ballsy. I don't take no shit from anyone.
You will. Love your content. Do
yep.
you plan to on doing IRL with the OTK gang in the future?
I do. I actually plan on going to Austin soon.
Nothing gonna crumb.
I plan on going to Austin pretty soon.
I'm a stud. I'm ballsy.
Yes?
I take no shit from anyone.
I can help you with getting an IRL backpack through my company if you are looking for one man. Would love to help.
Through your company? I'm kind of in the process of buying one right now just because like it's such an involved process to get one. And I've kind of gone through this rigmarole a few times, but if you're like 1,000% dead ass, very serious about this, please message my mods and I'll get in touch with you. But I'm like in the process of like just building one, but we assemble them for retail. All right. We'll talk about it. So I think that there is a best game in this genre, and it's this game. Digimon World 1, if you've never played it, I played it on stream before. This game is like perfect. It's so fucking fun. You go and you train in a gym, which I absolutely love. And then you go out and you fight monsters and like you get more options in your fight based on how smart your Digimon is, which is awesome. And then if you fight and beat like rare monsters, they come and they join your town, right? Which is crazy. But the Digievolutions in this game are fucking wild sauce, bro. Some of the Digimon you can get are so fucking cool. Like, look at this. What the fuck is that? And they're like so hard to get that it like keeps you playing this game for so long. Because you're like, oh, I want to get so-and-so, and I want to get so-and-so. And just when you think you've seen, like, everything that this game has to offer, there's some, like, weird secret or something you can unlock or something you can do late in the game, and it's so hard. I honestly think Digimon World 1 was a game that was, like, core memory for me. It's so fun. If you've never played it, there are ROMs of it. And you should absolutely give it a try. Probably because I enjoyed that game so much is why I have played the subsequent Digimons. Wow,
that's for a cool.
Lesson 3.
Thank you. Epilepsy Mon. That's a rare Mon right there.
Oh yeah, wow.
Thank you, Agent Orange.
8 months. The baby's just about ready to come out.
There's a PS4 sequel to Digimon World 1. What's it called? You should emulate it on stream one day. I did. I almost played the whole game. I got Metal Greymon. We blasted through it.
Wow, that's for a cool.
Nafla.
Mr. Magon line. Thank you for the prime. Digimon World Next Order. Digimon World Next Order. Whoa. Wait, you have two Digimon at once? This looks strange. I'd give this a try, though. I don't know. It's real hard to capture the magic of that first game. Just rolling around. Collecting Mons.
Oh, yeah, wow.
Ico rules. I did not enjoy next.
Enough, Karen.
37 months, my God. Next Order is not as good as World 1. Gonna say it now. Okay. Pokemon Stadium come. Pokemon Stadium is really fun to do a blind draft against your friend. Where you like both select a team blindly and then fight each other. Also the mini games on Pokemon Stadium, real ones know.
Cool.
Thank you so much. Cool. Real ones know about the Pokemon Stadium mini games. Pokemon Stadium mini games are fucking insane. Big facts. Evil Straight Guy, thank you for the 14 short months.
Thanks for all the content. Glad to see you killing it in life, RN.
Did you know Pokemon was inspired by Capsule Monsters and Ultraman 7? I didn't know that. Thanks for the picture at TwitchCon, dude. I really appreciate it. No worries. Are you shitting me? It's my pleasure. Pokemon League is the best puzzle or Pokemon game. Pokemon or Puzzle League? San Diego?
Oh, that's for a cool.
What about it?
Nefward.
I was there recently. William Nefward. I was there briefly for Comic-Con. Like right on the end of a long trip. And are you going? You mean for San Diego TwitchCon in October? Yeah. That's so long away, it feels like.
Oh, yeah, wow. That's very cool.
That feels like an eternity from now. Yeah, I'll be there.
In an art gallery wearing my Stay Dangerous merch. Thank you for being an inspiration.
Sheesh. Are you going to EVO August 6th? No. Tamagotchi or where it's at? Dude. Everybody experienced the joy of smuggling a Tamagotchi into their elementary school classroom only to have it fucking throw a fit because it was drowning in its own fecal matter and your teacher freaked out and confiscated it and then it drowned in poop. Everyone experienced that joy. Raising it for the full 48 hours of your weekend. I remember I'd be like, this weekend, I got it, bro. Friday, as soon as school's out Friday, I start raising the fucking Tamagotchi. I'm in. It evolves. 6 hours in. Boom. 24 hours later, Saturday, chilling. It evolves again. Bang. Sunday, right before school, it evolves one more time. And then you're like, just got to keep it alive through this one day of class. Going crazy in the classroom. Teacher's like, what is that? You're trying desperately to mop up the shit.
Wow, that's for a cool.
And it's a little fucking digi room. And you're like, please. She confiscates it. Miss Craig, no! I have to feed it. Sorry, you have a spelling test. It's in the drawer till the end of the day. You get it. Just fucking all the skull and crossbones on the screen. All that hard work. Dude, that came pouring back. Miss Craig was such a beat. No, she was one of my favorite teachers. I loved Miss Craig. She's incredible. Did you see the new Prey trailer? I think I did. Still can't spell to this day. I can't.
Oh yeah, well, that's for a cool.
My toaster shocks me if I touch it with a wet hand. It's wired wrong then. I would stop doing that. Hey, Will. Hope the stream's been good. It's been great. Okay, guys, here's the plan for the stream tonight. Little Billy Video Games is up and at it, okay? Here is the schedule. It's Saturday. I'm chilling. Do you understand? I took care of my sick dog all day. And so the content isn't going to be like lightning, riveting, insane, wild. Okay? It is going to be me playing games. And I'm okay with that. I don't know if you guys are. Probably not. You'll probably all leave. But I'm okay with that as well. Aiko, thank you for the bits. So here's the plan. All right? I am going to try Digimon Survive. All right? I'm going to try it. Maybe I hate it. Maybe I last 10 minutes playing this game and I'm out. Because there just might be too much damn dialogue in this thing.
Oh yeah, wow.
Burrito Dave, thank you so much.
Show underscore Dave underscore gifted a tier 1 sub to cheese underscore.
Oh yeah, wow, that's for a cool.
Thank you, Ico.
_Dave_ gifted a tier 1 sub to
Thank you, Burrito 10. Dave. Also, did you hear about galleys, men's penises? Ico, what are you saying? What are those words? What do those words mean?
Oh yeah, wow. That's
Effingham 30, thank you. One moment. Penis. Yep. You haven't heard about it? Nope. What was I going to say? Okay, so I'm going to try this game, but it looks very dialogue heavy. So I might get bored. I'm keeping it a buck with you guys. Will can't read my name. Yep. Baja blasting grope. Those are all words I know. The Baja blast was a pivotal part of my upbringing.
Wow, that's for a cool.
I can finally resip.
Galley men all lost their penises.
Oh yeah, wow, that's for a cool.
What did Ico, you put this here like it would explain something. What does this mean? This looks to be a woman who's in a cult, currently being held in a cult. The title means nothing. No, he's her cult. All right, well, let's...
Okay, folks, let me just sum up. I Skyped with Terrance Jenkins last night. I finally heard from him after a silence of 1.5 months. Around June the 21st, when Terrance was Skyping with me, Brent Spiner said, "Hey, yoo-hoo, Terrance, something's going on with Matthew McConaughey's penis." And what was happening was all of my men's penises were being attacked. There was a very serious malware in the computer system at Church of Gale, and it caused all the men at Church of Gale to cause them to have all sorts of penis afflictions. It was very painful. And let me just, they spent, the ordeal with the penises lasted for at least a good week in that June. So like from June 21st to June 28th, they were just having this ordeal with penises because of Jesuit trigger programming on the Church of Gale computers. They spent a lot of time in sick bay. Matthew practically had a vagina at that point.
This person is saying words. None of them mean anything. What the fuck? No, they do. They mean a lot. I mean, is she playing The Sims?
And what happened was Vladimir Putin, they found out that he ended up getting his bladder exploded. They had to put him in stasis where they froze him, and all sorts of things happened to him. He had heart attacks, and right in the middle of an operation to fix him for a heart attack, he woke up, and then he judo chopped the doctor. He felt bad about that, but this is like gut reflex with Vladimir. And he, when he woke up, he heroically pushed himself, which explains why the accurate pictures of Vladimir in the media made him look like he was almost dead. And he,
Is she reading a fucking Mad Lib? What is happening?
He managed to fly Church of Gale down to China. And on the way down, several nukes almost hit them because I guess they were going so fast, the Earth radars are not as good as Church of Gale radars, and they thought that Church of Gale was a new cocky or a nuke, and Vladimir had to outmaneuver that, and he heroically, even while his body was like thawing out from being frozen and everything, he managed to bring Church of Gale to land in China, and then he fell asleep,
oh, yeah,
and then
wow,
the rest of the guys
cool.
took over, and I think Brent Spiner was a leader in that, and they chose to go to China because Hu Jintao is, you know, on my marriage list, so they figured that'd be a good place to try to fix their penises. Hu Jintao apparently assigned some Chinese doctors to work on them, and they agreed with the doctors that they would be put under anesthesia and allow the doctors to operate on them. When they woke up, they looked down at their penises and saw this crisscross, just two crisscross bandages, and they realized that all of their penises had been surgically removed, and they all had vaginas. And they were so mad. And they had been asleep for 2 days for the operation when they woke up and saw this. So they spent a day looking for the Chinese doctors, and Vladimir, I believe he judo chopped them, and they got the their penises back.
What am I looking at? What is this? Is this just a person with mental illness? Is this a woman who's a paranoid schizophrenic, or is this performance art? I don't know.
Back. Their penises were in excellent condition because the reason the Chinese doctors stole the penises is because they had small
oh, yeah,
ones
wow,
and they wanted big
cool.
ones. So they
I'm
made their restored penises perfect. So with perfectly restored penises, Brent spent 3 days doing surgery to install the penises back on the guys. They left Matthew McConaughey's penis alone. So, but the other guys had to get their penises.
Who is this person?
As he drove his car underneath the Paramount Pictures cream and gold arches and into his studio parking lot, he felt his pulse rate quicken. He even now disliked the Spanish tile roofs of the studio because it reminded him that Gail was far away in Seattle, surrounded by evergreen mountains and cool, crisp air, and she had never been here in the Southern California.
Keep corporate greed, no monarchy.
Okay, I have...
Gail is my president.
Decided to reinstate the House and the Senate because it's not worth starting a war over. I will not become monarch.
Will you gotta tell us before you put the psilocybin directly into the stream?
Psilocybin? This ain't psilocybin. This is some crocodile. This is scary drugs.
Vote for that. I am not going to force myself on the people and the American people. Let me see here.
I'm not going to lie. I think this is a bit. I think this is a bit.
Oh, yeah, wow, that's very cool.
Nuclear bomb on the way. Need scientists and military now.
I cannot vouch for any other videos being toes safe.
Oh, God.
We have an emergency. The Jesuits are about to launch a nuclear bomb that has semen in it that will infect everyone. We need our scientists all over the world to help us stop this bomb. And also, it's going to be like Jesuit bukkake in a nuclear bomb, and it's headed...
Bro, that's so weird. That was the name of my metal band. Jesuit Bukkake.
Towards Canada, where Judge Terrance Jenkins is right now. Any scientists out there that can help us stop this bomb or come up with some sort of spermicide that will counter the germs that are going to come out of
the Star Wars cum defense system. We are creating a spermicide dome over the United States.
This bomb, contact
dude, this is what the Oppenheimer doc should be about. I have become death, dropper of loads.
Judge Terrance Jenkins at
God, I am one witty motherfucker, you know that?
Judge Terry Jenkins, JudgeTerryJenkins at yahoo.com. Judge Terry Jenkins, or go to Gerard Butler, GERARDBUTLERMD at gmail.com. The nuclear bomb is headed right towards Canada right now, where Terry Jenkins is. We need scientists and military to intervene this bomb.
So Terry Jenkins is under attack from a dirty cum bomb. A scum bomb. Is the intention to kill him or to somehow miraculously make him pregnant or just to minorly inconvenience him as cum rains from the heavens? I don't know. Oh, she's getting a call.
Hello?
Yeah, it's me again.
Yeah, keep talking. I actually have the video going right now, and I think you're being recorded.
Oh my goodness, I'm on video. That's amazing.
Yes, say what you need to say.
Well, our scientists on nanotechnology research team is saying that this is a new cocky. It's a new kind of nuclear bomb. It's a bomb that's got
Okay. So let me get this straight. Whoever is calling in is trolling the fuck out of her. Right? That is a troll. It takes one to know one. He's doing an accent. He's doing like a, oh my God, oh my goodness, oh my God. It's a new cocky. It's on the wood, they're gonna be cum flying from the sky.
Oh yeah, wow, that's for
and
mellowing out some totally legal portobello.
Hey, well, let's go. And this poor woman thinks she's getting insider information, Alex Jones style. And she's in her home gym, it looks like. This looks like one of the arms of an elliptical.
Bukkake in it. It's going to infect the whole world with Jesuit semen.
Okay, keep
going. So
that's
going. All I needed to tell you.
Okay.
But everyone,
I think you're being recorded. I hope so.
Okay, I hope so too,
okay.
Dan.
All right, so okay. I'm going to go.
Okay, bye-bye.
Oh yeah, wow, that's for cool.
What was that ending?
Bye-bye.
Just 5 seconds of unbroken staring.
Oh yeah, wow, that's for cool.
And then it just kind of ends. What the fuck is this? She has 10,000 subscribers? Okay, now this is interesting. This is going to tell me a lot about this person. Now, I am diving into something that no one else on the internet has watched. How do I know that? Because it has 50 views. I just cross-referenced Gail's name, and I found that she has a cooking channel. Also, now, we can cross-reference this cooking channel to her, I guess, whistleblower channel and see how crazy.
I'm going to be making herbed braised beef with tomatoes, and I'm lining up my ingredients. Sugar, salt, the measuring spoons that I'm going to be needing, tomatoes, beef.
Okay, this is looking pretty normal.
Let's see if I can remove into 6 portions. Let's go ahead and remove some of the fat. One.
Okay. I mean, these are some compelling camera angles here.
Powder.
Okay. She is seasoning the
camera.
Fuck out of that.
This way.
Okay. All right. Yeah, okay. Okay. Sure.
Between the stakes. Okay, let's go ahead and
thank you for those bits. Okay, now this is
to watch one of her victims.
This is a ludicrous amount of seasoning.
Alrighty. Lisa, plenty of time because I just started preheating the oven.
Okay, there's some broth. Huh.
30 more minutes. My alarm. Let me look back in the oven now. Let me. That's my alarm to remind me. Alright. Yeah.
How the fuck did she set off the fire alarm with boiled steak?
Okay, I'm gonna stick it back in the oven now. Let me turn this off. Okay, that looks good. That looks done to me. Let's throw in a little bit of parsley.
What is this art in the background?
Are you familiar with Caroline Constnow? Great YouTube comedy talent.
I think that's some furry shit.
I think what I'm gonna do before I eat it, I probably should eat it in a plate. It'd be easier to cut it.
What is she eating it on?
Tastes good. It's delicious. Mmm.
What in the fuck? Cooking with Gail.
As he drove.
Judge Terrence Jenkins? Wait.
Oh, there you are, Gail.
I'm still not here now?
Yes, I can see you now. Okay. Now, Gail, I feel that we need to have something settled here. I suspect foul play. I suspect foul play.
I think it's pretty obvious.
Now, Lori, what do you have to say for yourself? Do you know of what's going on here?
Of course I do, Judge. Brent Spiner is my husband, and the evidence is overwhelming. And he's always going to be my husband, especially when this bitch is dead. Didn't he say that sentencing was supposed to happen immediately? She's still alive.
Well, I have ordered the executioner was going to go out there in an ultrasonic jet. He was going to go out there and kill Gail and I have ordered him to stop. I have told him not to go because he was set to execute you. And then the jury surprised us with this and he was just getting ready to head out that direction. And so I told him to postpone that because I suspect that there's something a little fishy right here. So, Gail, you appreciate that I postponed the execution.
Will, what in God's green earth are we watching?
Actually, I think...
I'm going to be honest. I've been trying to wrap my head around that the entire time. I still have no idea.
Vladimir Putin appreciates me. I'm not afraid to die because when I meet God, I know I'm going to be in the right. But, you know, the problem is, well, you know what's going to happen if you execute me? Vladimir Putin, Brent Spiner, commit suicide.
See, that's weird, and we don't want that. We really don't want that.
I'm ready to meet God. I'm in the right. My conscience is clear. You want to kill me, go ahead. When I meet God, I'm clear. Lori, when you meet God, I feel sorry for you.
Yeah, so what we're going to do right now is I'm going to bring the woman up who read off the charges.
I'll tell you one thing, though. If you execute me, you're going to see a suicide in Vladimir Putin and Brent Spiner. They'll kill themselves. And probably most of the men on my marriage list, they'll kill themselves.
She doesn't.
Did she just say Vladimir Putin would fucking Romeo and Juliet himself? Wow. Okay. Well, I That, okay. Well, geez. That was a lot. Before I got cut off, I was gonna say that at 10 o'clock, I'm joining Jack Courage Dunlop, for a little bit with his, quest to win 100 Fall Guys crowns. Fook me over. Oh, you fucking slags. It's a lot of juice.
Thank you.
My God in heaven. Yeah, I want to play some Digimon Survive. I just called it Pokemon Survive. That new Digimon game was a lot of dialogue. Oh, boy. Shit. Fudge. It's mostly a visual novel? Ugh.
Oh, yeah, wow, that's very cool.
16 months, also glad to-
Real Lair Blair, thank you.
Central NJ to visit my partner and meet her parents was great. Did try the buffalo chicken.
I mean, should I just fuck around for an hour and then play it later? Oh, there's a- I'm looking at it on stream and there's a lot of reading.
Oh yeah, wow, that's very cool.
Yo, we'll have you played 20 minutes until dawn.
Someone is 35 hours into Digimon Survive? Holy shit. Oh my god. Oh fuck. I don't know if I'm built for that. Vagrant Holiday Japan, we watched that last time. Operation Soda Steel.
2008, and on a certain GameFAQs spinoff board, one user had to.
What the fuck is this?
Decided to undertake a daring heist. Epitaph Philip, or just Philip for short, posted a thread titled, "My Dream is Becoming a Reality, Operation Soda Steel." He shared some concept art drawn MS Paint.
This is the dumbest thing I've ever seen! A man in disguise is filling a cup with a hose that goes into a backpack that has 2 liters in it. His neck is clearly broken, and to help avoid suspicion, he's whistling.
In order to demonstrate,
let's.
The plan. As you can see, it's a bold design that's elegant in its simplicity. While on the outside you would appear as an ordinary patron just filling up your cup with soda, in reality the soda had done gone down the tube into a discreet container located in the backpack, and Philip was almost done constructing the-
Okay, dude. No, this is- This is not an airtight seal, sir. Sir! What did you spend 30 seconds on this? Come on, bro.
First version of the device. He shows off the cup with the tube.
The device.
As well as the actual container itself. He writes, "Check it out. The inner venting tube extends out to become the straw. Genius engineering. Actually, I don't think the vent tube is very necessary at all. but it's a cool idea. I tested it in the shower and it works pretty well. I ran out of hot glue though, so there were some small leaks. Hopefully I can complete it by tomorrow and take it out for a spin. I might record it. Taco Bell never know what hit him. Many people were quite amused by this concept. Some rightfully pointed out that this was a lot of effort just for several dollars worth of-
Someone get this man a government grant.
Soda. Why can't you just buy soda?
Yeah.
It'd be different if somehow you could do this with gasoline or like gold or something. Soda is inexpensive. I mean, don't get me wrong. The concept-
With the gasoline, you'd still be paying for the gasoline. What? You would just be pumping gasoline instead of it going in your car. You'd be pumping it in a fake cup with badly made seals out of hot glue that leak into a backpack and make you violently flammable.
Idea rock my balls. However, he explained, it's not about the soda. I probably won't even drink half of it. It's the accomplishment. And it's fun.
It's not about the money. It's about sending a message.
In fact, there was actually another reason why he had no choice but to pull off a stunt like this. I'm sure you're aware that in 2004, PepsiCo released a Mountain Dew flavor exclusive to Taco Bell restaurants.
Oh, fuck yeah, dude. I'm gonna keep it a buck. I'm gonna keep it a whole fucking dollar, kids. Cats and kittens. If you're too young to remember when Baja Blast was an exclusive flavor at Taco Bell, first of all, fuck you. Secondly, there was something about Mountain Dew, Baja Blast, at Taco Bell's that was infinitely more delicious than Baja Blast that you can acquire anywhere else. There was something about when it was a limited edition Taco Bell flavor that made it taste even sweeter, like a forbidden, delicious ambrosia nectar of the gods. I'm telling you, the other thing about Baja Blast that no one talks about, I saw Baja Blast pull men out of standing comas. I saw some of the drunkest, highest degenerates on the planet be returned to working order by a cheese bean crunch wrap burrito or whatever the fuck, some combination of those ingredients, and then a Baja Blast. It was like a tincture from the gods. It could truly resurrect you from the deepest, deepest state of unconsciousness.
It's known as Baja Blast.
Oh, there it is, baby. I would recognize that signature teal anywhere.
Sure. Nowadays, everybody knows that they've had limited run retail releases.
Caca.
Stores across the US and Canada.
Crap.
But back in 2008, the only possible way to get Baja Blast was at a Taco Bell location.
Yes.
Which, needless to say, is absolute tyranny of the highest degree. In a way, this could be seen as an act of rebellion against an unjust...
Yo, y'all know something else, too. I'm gonna say it. I'm gonna put it out there. The real ones will know what I'm talking about. The real ones will know right away what I'm talking about. The real ones. McDonald's Sprite tastes better than normal Sprite. Period. I don't know why. I don't know the science. There's something about McDonald's Sprite. That shit is cracked.
System. I believe you could easily argue that in this scenario, stealing Baja Blast would be the morally correct thing to do. User John Cena 23 was the first to...
John Cena 23. Oh, John Cena 23, a scholar!
Just Baja Blast is the beverage of choice, and many others echoed this sentiment. TC better fucking fill it up with Baja Blast. They only sell it at Taco Bell.
Yep.
It'd be so awesome to have a huge container of it.
Uh-huh.
Oh, I'll get the Baja Blast. In terms of...
Why did he say that like a fucking supervillain? Oh, I'll get the Baja Blast. Oh, I'll get it. and I'll have it too. Like fucking something Martin Shkreli would say. Oh, I'll get the Baja Blast.
In terms of construction, he realized that, despite the iconic look seen in the concept art, a backpack design simply wasn't going to be feasible because of possible gravity-related flow issues. He instead planned to utilize a shoulder strap duffel bag approach. He also began answering questions from other users. When asked about the cup part, he explained that he planned to buy a large drink at the restaurant in order to avoid suspicion.
Uh-huh.
Then he'll switch it out with the rigged cup system when nobody's looking.
So... He's buying a large soda in a restaurant that allows for refills, and he is developing a system to steal from them when he could just refill the beverage. It's not about money. It's about sending a message.
Someone asks if he's concerned that it'll look suspicious just standing at the soda fountain filling up the same cup for like 10 minutes straight. He says that he'll try to go during off hours when it isn't too busy, and that he also might make multiple trips instead of doing it all at once.
Can you imagine, bro, being a Taco Bell employee at 1 a.m, you're definitely baked. You're definitely fucking stoned. You're rip shit stoned. And the whole time you're like, all right, just keep it together, dude. Just fucking serve these crunch wraps and you're going to be a-okay. And then at 1 a.m, a guy dressed like two fucking 12-year-olds trying to break into a movie theater, carrying a duffel bag, comes in and orders a large soda. Maybe he gets a bean burrito just to cover his tracks. And you go, all right, dude, run away. And you give him the cup. And he goes over to the soda fountain and he starts filling it up. 10 seconds go by. 20 seconds go by. A minute goes by. You're stoned out of your gourd. You're like, oh my God, dude, what's going on? Is fucking time slowing down? Someone else is trying to order a fucking Doritos Locos taco. And you're like ringing it up. And out of the corner of your eye, this guy is just making unblinking eye contact with you.
Blast.
While endlessly finish filling a drink. And you're like, oh my God, dude, am I freaking out? I think I'm freaking out. 10 minutes go by and you're like, what is going on, dude? He's a fucking magician, bro. He's a demon.
Oh yeah, wow, that's for a cool. Yeah.
You're trying to get the attention of your buddy at the drive-thru. You're like, dude, I'm not trusting my eyes right now, bro, but I think there's a demon at the soda fountain.
Oh yeah, wow.
I think there's a fucking soda demon in here, dude.
It's about the cup part. He explained that he planned to buy a large in a restaurant where the soda machines aren't clearly viewable by the employees. Hard to find, but I can think of a few. Thanks, DTA. Very cool. Many people began offering engineering advice. Ty Caro suggests creating an implement which could puncture the bottom of a cup instead of bringing...
An implement! The device has an implement. Wow, this is getting advanced.
...in an already rigged up one. Eventually, people realized that the soda falling in from the top of the tank would noisily splash down and make the soda flat, so they brainstormed some alternate designs.
That would be the funniest part if it was just loud as fuck. Just loud ass fucking frothing soda. Like Niagara Falls.
Driveway points out that this particular design wouldn't work since the tube at the bottom would
create
pressure as the tank is filled up.
Okay.
Matt Johnson Extreme theorizes that using some kind of ramp could prevent the soda from going flat. Much theory crafting and MS painting ensues while people wait for...
Okay. Listen, I am not some big city scientist, but this is Tyler Blevins. This is popular Fortnite player Tyler Blevins, a.k.a. Ninja,
stealing Baja Blast. I would recognize that bandana hair combo anywhere. The streaming really had gone wrong for him at that. This is what Ninja was doing before Fortnite, dude. This is why they call him Ninja. It's also what dyed his hair that color. The iconic teal was actually a Baja Blast overdose.
Update from Philip. The next day, he posts letting people know that he's still working on the contraption, that he appreciates all the feedback and general enthusiasm. He posts another update the following day discussing his work on the project. However, he decides he needs a better container, as the one he's working with right now isn't airtight around the seal. A couple days later, he posts a picture of the new...
No. No! This looks like something you find at a meth lab! No! Dude, it's a Taco Bell! Just go up and fill a fucking container! They're not gonna stop you!
I drink it all up.
Bro, if you just went up with a Gatorade container and put it under the nozzle, no one is gonna stop you. Like one of those giant drums from a fucking football sideline. Not one of the employees is gonna stop you. Instead, this looks like something that goes in a septic line. I mean, God, look at the hot glue. This is gonna make you sick, dude, please. This is the best he could do. Look at the cup. Dude, the extra large is half as big as the fucking container.
Container and tube system. And the day after that, he pulls a picture of the version.
It looks so shitty.
Ultimately, he ended up removing the vent that was running through the transfer tube since it restricted the flow of liquid too much, opting for a small tube on the top of the container.
Okay.
Found an appropriately sized bag in order to conceal it.
Sure.
However, he stated, no guarantees, but I might try it tonight with a friend.
Oh.
He once again reiterates that, I'm well aware doing this for the sole purpose of getting soda is a dumb idea. That's why I'm not only doing it for that reason.
Fun project. Take research money out of things like cancer and AIDS and give it to this fucking man. Ladies and gentlemen, the fight against cancer has been we're giving up. We're funding this guy now. Holy shit, dude. Oh my God. All the fucking pink ribbons just turn into teal Baja Blast ribbons.
Project, it will be a good story to tell. Not to mention it provides entertainment for all of you guys.
Oh my God.
People wait patiently for a couple hours when finally he returns. Fucking did it. I'm gonna upload the video now.
Oh no.
Any results? I filmed it with my shitty digicam. It's in three separate parts.
No.
I'm not gonna edit anything out or anything.
No.
Just upload them raw.
No.
And I should note the filming is really shaky at parts. I felt sort of weird holding a camera recording everything, so at parts.
This dude had a fucking Taco Bell cup in one hand with a blatant tube coming out of it. He had a duffel bag over the same shoulder. And in the other hand, he's just holding a digicam of him getting the soda as he is dressed like two 12-year-olds in a trench coat sneaking into a boob movie. This is amazing.
Parts, I put it down by my side to make it look less obvious. Yes, he explains that he was actually not the one who collected the soda from the machine.
Oh.
He was hanging back recording the video for the...
Oh.
Well, he had recruited his friend to wear the contraption.
Okay, his friend is the real hero for wearing the contraption.
The Baja Blast. About an hour after returning, he posted a mega upload.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. He posted it in 6 parts, or is this all the same video? Okay, this is all the same video. Sorry, I thought for a second this man had an hour of Baja Blast footage. I thought this man uploaded 6 10-minute videos. I was wrong. but that would have been incredible.
Link containing the raw footage of the event. Immediately, he is showered with praise from the community. People were very impressed.
Where's the video?
On this insane premise. Even I chimed in with some insightful commentary. Wow, this topic is mega awesome. Someone asks if the employees said anything. He explains that, and I know this is going to be hard to believe, the minimum wage Taco Bell employees didn't really give a shit or pay attention.
That's what I said right from the beginning. You could have filled up a fucking jug. Holy shit, what the fuck is this? Sorry, it's for the pod. I think we're recording a new episode tomorrow. Okay.
Mention to him at all. The next morning, he posts an update.
Well, I feel neglected. I'm sorry. I'm doing my best.
The status of the soda.
Potato is 2.5 gallons.
2.5 gallons. So I think it's safe to say we collected about 2 gallons. As of this morning, it's got a little fizz left, but it's definitely gotten flatter.
Okay.
So this is the part of the video where I should show you the raw footage.
Yes.
But unfortunately, and believe me, it really pains me to say this, I can't. I mean, obviously Mega Upload is down now, and sadly, I'm almost certain that this raw footage simply does not exist anywhere on the internet anymore. And I promise you, I was extremely thorough in my search.
But are you as thorough as I am? I'm typing in Baja Blast device in YouTube.
What you're seeing here is a piece of internet history.
Oh, I found it already.
Yeah, wow, that's for a cooler.
Here, Taco Bell, my friend. And we're about to deploy our device. See how it goes.
13 years ago, user Epitaph Philip published a video is this story from the YouTube channel Steal the Day Rob.
There it is.
Yes.
There it is. There it is. Are you shitting me? Like, you can click, dude. Even though this thing was recorded on a fucking Etch-a-Sketch, you can still clearly see the hose. Holy shit, bro. All right, hang on. Let's see the footage.
There was only one moral, just way of getting it, and that was to steal it.
Proudly say I'm one of privileged enough to enjoy Baja Blast in the confines of my own home.
A hot blast. Mm-mm. Mm-mm. Nothing hits the spot like a hot flat blast. A blast right to the face, dude.
It was...
What a goddamn hero. All right.
It probably still does exist somewhere.
I found it in 2 seconds, bud.
On someone's ancient hard drive. And I watched it back in the day, so I can 100% promise you it did exist, but I can't show you the raw footage of the event. However, user Navy Greg cut the raw footage down
to
one short 4 megabyte video, which was also distributed and shared around by Philip. And thankfully, this video does still exist. The editing is kind of strange, cutting between the aftermath and the event itself, and it deliberately avoids showing the bagman's face, so it's a little jumpy at times. But here it is, in all its 240p, 4 megabyte glory.
Yes.
See where to start, the cup.
Can I have your drink?
So they get the cup.
Extra large Taco Bell cup we got beforehand. Put this funnel in here.
Oh, yeah.
Super glued it.
Oh, look at all that glue.
Bottom.
Oh, look at all that glue going right into your...
Then add...
Oh, yeah, wow. That's for a cooler.
Top every day, thank you.
which then goes through the sleeve of the jacket.
Sure. Yeah, this all makes sense. Nothing conspicuous at all here.
Down to the side bag. Which conveniently perfectly fit. I don't know if you can see, but there, there's some light. Bring it out in the light. Oh my God.
Look at all that Baja.
Holy shit. That is a lot of Baja.
I told you.
Alright. The container. And there's the fruit.
The device.
So, that's pretty much it. Proudly say I'm one of the few people privileged enough to enjoy Baja Blast in the confines of my own home.
Yep.
Wow.
And right after that, he took a nice warm blast to the face.
Incredible stuff.
A nice warm flat blast to the face.
Many people asked him if he planned on uploading his accomplishment to YouTube. This is what he had to say about the matter. I'm still considering that. I really want to, because obviously I want to share it with the world. Plus it's easier to view. But on the other hand, I'm a little scared of getting caught.
A little scared of getting caught. Caught doing what? Drinking a normal American amount of soda? Have you ever been to a 7-Eleven? Do you know what a fucking big gulp looks like? I love that they lived in fear. Dude, I wish... Dude, this is like... This would have been a great challenge. I'd take this over the Tide Pod challenge every day. Soda device over Tide Pod every day.
Then again, it would be hard to track me down based on only what I look
like. And ladies and gentlemen, remember, he went to the front and bought two large drinks and some food to cover his tracks.
Like, it's pretty...
Taco Bell that's a lost leader for them.
Same, really. It's hard to imagine someone taking the effort to track me down because I stole like a dollar worth of soda, or what, like $20 even counting markup. Or it's arguably not even illegal at all, because there are free refills.
Yeah.
I mean, it's possible that someone could even drink that much soda in one sitting if they...
That's exactly what I'm saying, Phoenix Wright.
...wanted to. So, I don't know. What do you guys think? Is it too far-fetched that anything bad happens to me /
Objection!
Anyone even cares? Soon after that, he posted, I've decided I am going to put it on YouTube, but a better edited version, and a clear disclaimer stating I don't condone stealing. It technically isn't stealing, arguably, and emphasizing the
objection
being a fun project. However, due to events
objection
that transpire, he would never actually end up uploading the video to YouTube.
But why?
You see, a couple hours after he made that post, someone in the thread noticed that the 4 megabyte version of the video was already uploaded.
No.
CollegeHumor.com.
No.
Looks like I just got ripped off.
He got stolen from.
Yes, some fucking guy called Steve just went ahead and re-uploaded it without even asking. With the incorrect title of Operation Baja Blast as well, I might add. And apparently...
I would love to recruit Michael Reeves to recreate this. I would love to get like one of the most brilliant men on the internet to help me steal soda.
Apparently the jackasses over on College Humor had a somewhat negative reaction to it, although I can't find any of the comments archived. This whole experience gave Phillip...
Alan Pan recreated it? Yeah, I watched that. I saw that video, too.
It's about uploading the video to YouTube, and ultimately he never did. Thanks a lot, Steve, you fucking prick. Despite this, apparently the video did receive a fair amount of views on College Humor over the years, even inspiring a copycat incident in 2011.
Okay.
On YouTube, you can find some guy made a video called Operation Baja Blast 2, where he and his friends perform a similar caper. However, their setup involves directly filling empty 2-liter bottles. This guy directly
saw
the original video as an inspiration.
That's dumb.
So clearly it had...
If you're going to do it, you got to step it up. I don't know how you would step it up, but it's got to be something like ridiculous. It's got to be something very humorous.
Some fans. However, as the College Humor site is now defunct, I was afraid this video would be lost to the sands of time. However, there exists one re-upload of it from some random account in 2016 called Re-Upped for Justice with the description, "I did not create this video, I only re-uploaded it." Here's a direct, personal message to you specifically, the person watching this video.
Oh, yep.
If you see an internet video you really like,
sure,
theoretically might want to watch it again someday,
yep,
you should download it.
Oh.
Just assume it'll be there forever, that somebody else will do it. Anything can be taken down at any time for any reason.
Oh, that's true.
The only guarantee you'll ever be able to watch something again is if you literally have it backed up to your hard drive.
Okay.
If you don't know how to download YouTube videos, don't worry. It's simple. Just go to www.google.com and figure it out. Man, what a ride it's been. Thank you for indulging me and listening to this tale.
Wow. Hey, we'll support Cybershell. Go check them out. I'm subscribing. That was a great video. All right, let's see. This is the Alan Pan video that did 3 million views.
A short list
from this company. Every pour and information about every pour, including date, time, machine, location, volume of drink, and what drink was dispensed, are all recorded and put into a database for your review.
These so-called smart cups are in pretty much every theme park now and apparently most of Europe. At Universal Studios Hollywood, their soda dispensers only work with their $17 souvenir cups. And if you and you come back another day with the cup, well, guess what? It's $10 to reactivate it. To reactivate a cup so that it works as a cup. If I buy a soda cup from your fast food establishment, I better be...
Wait, that's at Universal?
At Universal Studios Hollywood, their soda dispensers only work...
Now that's the dispenser we have to hit.
With their $17 souvenir cups.
Now that's the dispenser you gotta hit.
With the cup, well, guess what? It's $10 to reactivate it. To reactivate a cup so that it works as a cup. If I buy a soda cup from your fast food establishment, I better be able to fill it with 2 cent sugar bubble water as many times as I want.
Crunch Smash, thank you for the Prime.
I didn't buy the cup, I'm renting it. It's time to bring back Operation Soda Steal.
Oh, is this where he stole from?
If I put the backpack on like this, here's the smart part, is the hood goes down. You see that? You see that? And then we've got our modified Taco Bell cup. The barb just goes on like that. So now, watch this. I can put my hand here.
Okay, his device is very good.
It looks like I'm holding the cup. It looks natural, right? So you think it's just like a normal cup. I push this button here.
Okay.
And it goes down.
That is amazing.
And it's totally ending up at the backpack.
Okay, this dude is, that implement is good.
You're supposed to be like, ah!
I did, wait, what came undone, did it?
This hose, is that supposed to, oh yeah, this is.
Oh no, I might have pulled it out when I was leaning over.
Do you even drink soda?
I've been trying to avoid it recently. Or like, it's got a lot of sugar.
Yes. Oh my God, there's a camera in the cup?
It doesn't look like Baja Blast at all.
Wait, that ain't no Baja Blast.
I see a lot of bubbles.
That ain't Baja Blast.
Can you look at the tube? Is there anything going? It's not really pumping. I kind of just need, like, it needs gravity for some reason. Turns out you can't really pump carbonated fluid. In fact, soda dispensers actually carbonate the water right when it leaves the nozzle.
Oh.
Wish I'd known that. We just gotta get more.
There's something wrong with this.
Basically, the carbonation comes out around the spinny part of the pump, the impeller, and forms a big gas bubble around the thing that actually moves the fluid, so the fluid doesn't move.
Oh, the implement isn't working.
Philip didn't actually use...
Dude, the fact that I've never seen this drawing as someone's profile photo is a fucking shame.
The design he made in MS Paint. He came up with a simpler method where there was a funnel in the cup with a tube that led to a container in a duffel bag that was always under where the cup was. So it was entirely...
Yeah, dude, you gotta go lo-fi with this bad boy.
Gravity fed. Epitaph Philip may actually be a genius. So I'm gonna redesign my device so it's just like the original Operation Soda Steal, and I'm gonna go to Universal Studios Hollywood.
Nice.
And they're not gonna know what hit them. Now, I don't wanna waste the pump design that I already made. Luckily, okay. This year I'm part of a YouTube Maker Secret Santa. There's about 12 of us, and we're all randomly assigned to give gifts to each other. And this year, I got Kids Invent Stuff. They take kids' invention ideas and build them in real life. They're really cool. And if I reverse the soda stealing system, I end up with sort of a magic bottomless cup that refills itself, which I think
is
an idea that...
Okay, that's pretty... I like it.
...kid would come up with for an invention. Ah, child-friendly apple juice, my favorite. That's good. Another!
Okay.
This is the exact opposite of what I was trying to do, but it's still... pretty neat in a way, I think.
Dude, I need that device and I need to go into a baseball game and get absolutely shithoused. That would be incredible to try and sneak that into like a baseball or a football game and get absolutely decimated.
So, Merry Christmas, Kids Invent Stuff.
We millennials don't actually...
Swamp 15, thank you.
Oh, the juice!
Our houses.
Okay, he went to Universal on a rainy ass day, so he's gonna be the only person there.
Borrow our educations from the man. And as if that wasn't enough, now he's coming for our free refill.
First time chatter. The Jews? No, the juice. Christberry, king of the Jews.
Like, that's like literally all we have left. And it's so little. It's so little to ask for. Just let us have this one.
Thank you, Psy72.
Thing. So after sneaking the soda steel components past security, I reassembled our last hope for an equitable future. My name is Alan.
That park is empty. And I've been to Universal before on a rainy day, and it's a ghost town.
This is Operation Soda Steel.
So, this cup has already been modified to work with the soda stealing system. There's a half-inch hole underneath this tape. Hopefully, they don't notice.
No, I thank you.
Does anyone ever complain about like the refills and how it costs like $10 to refill
the
cup?
Really, because the drinks are like $4.50.
Right.
So if you get one or two drinks, you actually pay for the activation.
Right, but then isn't the problem that the drinks cost $4 or $5?
Yeah.
Jesus Christ, that's loud. My ears. Ah!
See you on the other side. So hit the, oh, there it goes.
The device was working perfect.
It's going a little fast. No, that's okay. It's okay. It should.
But the man was one step ahead of me.
No! You can get your next refill.
What? It's got a time lock?
9 minutes and 46 seconds? No! It counts the volume. It counts the volume of the drink that it dispenses. Oh, no. RJ, I think this is going to take a little longer than I thought it was. You're okay working overtime, right? What is that?
Okay, this would be a perfect thing to hack with Mike Reeves. To figure out how they have a changing SKU code on the cup.
What does that mean? Is that a yes? Okay, let's go. I'm not leaving until we have 4 liters of Coke Zero Cherry Vanilla, okay?
I had come way too far to quit now, so we spent the next 2 hours...
No.
...every soda dispenser in the park.
No.
10 minutes between refills. Nothing is going to come between me and my soda.
Keep going. Go. Are you kidding me? It's actually a video. This place sucks. Like, it's only four.
Look at how empty it is, too. On a rainy day, Universal is a ghost town.
Like, it's only 4 soda machines here, and my arm's getting tired, and like, as much as this...
The SKU code doesn't change? That's what I'm saying. We have to change the SKU.
When you think about it, we're actually only getting the exact amount of refills that we're allowed to.
Let's take a look at what we got.
Ooh! That's 4 liters of soda.
Oh my God. He actually has the split bottles.
Be able to drink in the park all at once. Oh, it's spilling everywhere.
It tastes really weird because we mixed like lemonade and stuff in here because a lot of the machines were out. You really taste the peach and the cherry.
Oh, God.
That this ended up costing about $427 for the annual passes and for the cup. The point, it's not about the money. It's about the message.
It's not about the money. It's about sending a message.
Oh, God, that's good. Okay, I'm at a Christmas party. We've got a gift from, I think this is from a Stephanie. Like, she used to be called a Stephanie Explains It All, but now she's just a Stephanie. Merry Christmas, Alan. I really hope you like your brand new custom-made tarot card reader. Yeah, so I use a Stephanie as like kind of a tarot card reader to figure out what I'm doing with my life.
What happened to the soda backpack?
Yeah, I'm not sure if I really wanted to let everyone know that, but here we are. Sending you,
this is my name.
Secret Santa, and this one good too. We all convenience.
He just resolves it there. Well, I demand more.
Once you sign up, you'll.
Here's that video, by the way. That's Alan Pan. That video is great. I like that a lot. I'm subscribing. I'm hitting the bell, baby. That was pretty. That was pretty fun. That was pretty cool. That was pretty good.
Oh yeah, wow. That's very cool.
Your little goddess. What's up, girl? How you doing? Thank you. Let's take a trip back to sanity, why don't we? I'm gonna be honest. I respect your patience because you dropped the same link with the same comment an hour ago before I got into the soda tangent. And I saw it. And I read it. And I didn't click it. And you waited an hour. You waited through an hour of soda lunacy. You waited through the ups, the downs, the laughing, the crying. And the moment I got done, you had that message waiting. And you went, bam, enter. And you know what? God damn it. I'm going to reward that level of patience. Okay?
Shaping up a new jump here. Just gonna send it.
It's Larry the Enticer best of, but it's a Larry the Enticer best of video filmed on an Etch-a-Sketch. I love Larry the Enticer. There's something magic about a Canadian wearing a Canadian tuxedo just injuring the fuck out of himself. Just give it shit.
Thank you for the fire content, Neff.
It's a little dark, but... You guys silly? I'm
CK, thank you. Oh, yeah. Hey, what are those two Canadians that hurt the fuck out of themselves and they always say, give it shit?
Well, that hurt, but the ET still runs, so round two.
She's tweaked.
Pug life, that's it. Oh, he's dead.
Snow's too soft. Another day, another beer.
This kid is a legend.
You guys have any food? Never mind. I think I got a slice in the old ET. There she is.
Oh, yeah.
Not like a slice of meat lovers after a good night. Had a couple bushes. Picked up the old ET. Should be running good for...
Gonna be a good day. Just gonna send it.
Oh, use the zinger, too.
This bike back. Y'all thought wrong. I'm just gonna keep on sending it.
Let's crack this baby open.
If you like Larry the Enticer, listen, I love Larry. I love his whole thing. I love his image. There is a spiritual successor. He is the spiritual successor to this group, though. Pug Life. Pug Life is the greatest, okay? Their videos are so good. I can't even. Here,
okay,
here's.
So friggin', we're in Inwoods, boys, and this is gonna be friggin' awesome. Look at this. Buddy Van Doodle, he's on the chair.
This Canadian man's name is Buddy Van Doodle.
Got the jump set up over here. Let's go have a look. So here he is just freaking doing some practice laps. We got the freaking jump set up. Look at the hangulations. So he's just...
Look at the hangulations. Mike, thank you so much. That's a technical term. A lot of you Zoomers and amateurs don't know what a hangulation is, but you can see it's the angle of this jump and how it's perfectly calculated to go directly through this appliance.
Doodly doo, and he's gonna clear that friggin'. It's gonna be awesome.
No, he's not.
Friggin' right.
Listen, I hate to give you guys a spoiler. He's not gonna clear shit.
Never, bud. Oh, hang on to her.
Where did I get this fire shirt? Digital Monster.
Just all for her up, eh? Give her shit.
Give her shit. Buddy Van Doodle.
This is gonna be awesome.
Oh, real stable.
Friggin' right, we got Buddy Van Doodle here.
Look at that protective gear. Oh, man, he's wearing the fucking grizzly suit, dude. You could put him in between the pipes or you can put him through a wall. He's ready for anything, boys and girls.
Cam, he's going to do a big friggin' jump. Check this out. Holy shit. This is going to be awesome. Hip, hip.
Oh, yeah. Give her shit.
Oh, shit. Here he friggin' goes, boys. Out for a friggin' rip. Oh, dick. Oh, dick. Holy shit.
That'll never get old. That'll never get old. That's the greatest thing I've ever seen. That's the greatest thing I've ever seen. Holy shit.
Oh, dick.
American culture, sir. Sir, Americans could never. This is as Canadian as the maple leaf itself. This is as Canadian as a Mountie fucking a beaver. This is Canadian as shit.
Oh, dick. Holy shit.
Is this the guy from season two?
Buddy Van Doodle. The helmet wasn't even strapped on.
You okay, buddy?
I'm good, boy.
Oh, friggin' rights, you do. Friggin' rights, do your friggin' curtsy, bud.
If you can't enjoy idiots driving poorly made golf carts through appliances, I don't know what to do for you. Okay? All right? It's the greatest. I sat down and I watched all of these. They are incredible.
Oh, friggin' right.
And you know what makes these videos possible? The fact that Canada has socialized medicine. And then after these men shatter their bones, they're able to go get free, affordable healthcare to reset their spines, to stitch together their spleens.
The big, big jump, boys. Friggin' right. Swamp by God.com. Yeah, we did. Woo! Yeah.
Awesome. Okay, this is the most absurd hairstyling I've ever seen in my life. What is going on here?
Yeah.
Awesome. He's probably not gonna make it.
No, there's no way. But it's gonna be awesome for my movie. Yeah. Okay, hold on a second.
For my movie. Oh,
friggin' rights, boys, here we friggin' go. Inwood, Ontario. Hap hap! Oh dick, boys. Oh dick.
Oh dick, give her shit.
Oh, dick. Oh fuck, he's not giving her. Oh, what happened? Oh, what the dick?
Oh, there it is. Give her shit.
Holy!
Oh, God!
Are you all right, buddy? Holy fuck.
directly to the hospital. God. If I could go down this rabbit hole forever. Pyramid Pliance Jump, we'll do one more. We'll do one more.
Right, boys,
it's Buddy Van Doodle.
Friggin' Buddy Van Doodle and Scotty McFoddy. Friggin', what do you think of this new jump, boys?
Awesome.
Look at the landing ramp.
Totally gonna make that.
Yeah, look at the landing ramp. Yeah. I think you can totally make it.
Oh, dude, look at those dangulations.
I think you can totally make it. Let's see if we can't get, like, the wide angle onto it, eh?
Yeah.
So if he friggin', if he hits her full bore.
Yep.
Just clips that, maybe.
Sure.
Friggin' lands her. We got.
Makes sense.
Percussions. It's like.
Dude, there is some strong Canadian geometry that's going into this jump. They were doing the math on this thing like NASA.
Friggin' better than a wrestling ring, buddy. It's better than a wrestling ring, that is right there. But that's my old shed wood and a couple old appliances. Mm-hmm. Friggin'
old shed wood and a couple appliances. Yep.
Pyramid Pliance Jump, boys. Look at them. Look at them over there. Just dickered. Son of a dick.
Oh, we got a friggin'
dickered son of a dick.
Oh, yeah, wow.
Carter, cool. Give her shit. You gotta give her.
Even work, yeah, after the last.
Just dickered.
Okay. First try.
It was cool, that friggin'.
Friggin' awesome.
Oh, yeah, that looks safe. None of the wheels are the same thing. Oh,
Buddy Fuscotti, what do you think of this, buddy? Oh my goodness, what do you think?
Oh, dick.
Oh, dick.
Right? Oh, dick.
Oh shit. Oh, we got parts of his pads falling off. This is gonna be awesome. What happened to yourself, buddy? Eh? One by guy by cam. Eh? No cheat.
Okay, here we go. Wait
for the- oh yeah, this looks safe.
Oh, it's elite.
I love these guys.
It's over here, boys, but friggin' rights, we're ready to go. Hip, hip! Oh, dick. Here he friggin' goes, boys. Pyramid Pliance jumping inward. We got oh, dick. He had to abort. Had to abort.
Bad approach.
Friggin', son of a dick. Frig sucks. So dick.
Dude, wait, I want to go back. Look at that wheel. Look at that wheel. That's before he even hit the jump. What is going on there?
Son of a dick. Frig suck, the chair's so dick. Like, it's just got so much Ackerman onto it that it just can't keep all the wheels on the ground. You can't keep all the wheels on the ground for Frig Snacks. I don't know why.
I thought you were the paramedic.
Oh, yeah.
What are you doing up there?
Frog Snacks?
Okay, boys, here we go, take two. Friggin' hip hip!
Oh yeah, send her.
Oh, I hope
give
he gets
her
the
shit.
Speed. I hope he gets the speed. Oh, friggin' rights!
Oh yeah!
Shit! Friggin' rights he did! That was awesome! Do your friggin' curtsy, bud! Holy shit!
Nailed it. That's good shit. That right there, it don't get much better than that. You know? It don't get much better than that. We got a little time left before I help Jack with his 100 crown mission. Fall guying it up. Arnar. Ray's last jump. Next video, please. Prage, about the 2000s forum argument.
There was a discussion on a message board. It was active for 2 days, and then it was locked. Since then, it's been viewed more than 3 million times.
So listen. I never posted on this forum. I don't know any of these people, but it's a story I have to talk about. It is the dumbest internet fight I have ever seen.
This is a thread from a body.
Okay. You got my attention. Dumbest internet fight ever. Why fucking not? Huh? Why fucking not? I'm playing Fall Guys later. My brain is already a fucking puddle of goo.
Bodybuilding.com message board. It was recently unearthed by Reddit, and it dates back to May of 2008.
Is this still a little quiet? Let me juice the volume. Let me juice it a bit.
Afternoon, when a guy asks whether it's safe to do a full body workout every other day. Fair question, right?
There you go.
Someone answers, yeah, it's pretty much fine, and he answers back.
Volume good, sure, ones if it is.
Times a week isn't overtraining. 4 to 5 times a week. Let's just draw that out real quick, all right? Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, cat, dog, huh? Okay, there we go. Yep, 5 times. A couple other nice folks show up and chip in. Yeah, don't worry about it. Every other day is fine. And then Stevie KM3 shows up. Wait, he says, that doesn't make sense. If you go every other day, you couldn't possibly go 5 times in a week. That's 3.5 times a week. Hold on, let me draw this up. 7 divided by 2. Yep. 3.5 times, he's right. Josh answers back, no, it's not 3.5, it's 4. Look. And oh my heavens, look at that. Monday, Wednesday, Friday, Sunday. He's right too. Justin27 shows up and comes back at him. No, 7 divided by 2 is 3.5. The Josh reiterates, no, 4 times a week, genius. What we have here are grown adults who can't agree on how many days there are in a week. This isn't done. This is not even close.
No. No.
So you can see where the Josh messed up here. He counted Sunday twice. He made a dumb mistake, but who among us, right? I mean, we've all been there. The thread goes quiet for about an hour, almost as though everyone is kind of digesting what the Josh just said. Finally, Stevie steps in again. You double counted Sunday. Grow up and admit when you are wrong. And with no hesitation, the Josh offers a 2-point retort. Delete it for double post sorry, and are you... We're going to run into the R word a few times here, and while I have the opportunity, I just wanted to say that I don't like that word. I'm not going to use it. The word hurts people,
based.
And if you think otherwise, you should ask around. Anyway, Josh doubles down on his argument by drawing up a calendar.
Manny, thank you.
Two different ways, by the way. I wish I could show you that calendar, but this is an 8-year-old post, and unfortunately, it looks like it's just been lost to the sands of time. This, given my understanding of the Josh's argument, is my best approximation of what it might have looked like. So, yes, he does come up with 4 days of exercise a week here. That's what you get when you add an extra day. Another hour of silence, as though the others are like, did he really say that? And then the floodgates open, and we are off. Justin27 goes at the Josh with both barrels. He's actually double posting at him. Justin posts twice. Josh posts twice to answer both of those posts. Left, right, left, right. It's like a boxing match. Shit is on, Josh.
My calendar is 14 days. Maybe you should try counting on your fingers.
Justin, okay, I will. It's 15. Let's count with him. Yep, he's right, it's 15. Justin continues to nail at the root of the problem. Sunday through Saturday is a week. There are 7 days in a week, so Sunday through Saturday is 7 days.
This is so dumb.
Did you never take basic elementary math?
And he counts too. He gets the same number of days, but he's counting starting on Monday. He says you don't count the day that you start the workout program.
Oh.
Justin, rightly, responds. What do you mean you don't start counting on Sunday? It's a fucking day.
I already answered that.
No, you didn't. You said that you didn't feel like it should be counted as a day.
Hey, I didn't say that. I will have feelings. Shut up.
Okay, now y'all get ready, because Josh is about to drop some knowledge on you.
Okay.
It's like math, he says. Oh, this is going to be good. If you add 4 and you add 3, that gives you 7.
Hold up. Let me draw this out.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. All right, so this is the foundation of the Josh's argument, that you don't count what day it is when you're counting days.
Again, you don't count what day it is when you're counting days. I didn't exaggerate that. He said it verbatim.
You don't count what day it is when counting days. Fuck it. Fine. Let's follow this rule. 0+0+0+0+0+0+0+ Well, hey, look what the cat dragged in. It's SB Nation's own Ryan.
How old is this?
In the middle of every.
This goes on for 18 minutes. Stop.
Drop some of that body fat and shut.
Okay, listen. If this video wasn't a million years old, I would watch more, but I can only handle so much. My brain can only take so much of that. I've done what I could do. You ever watch Cooking with Jack? What is this? Oh, no.
There's three of about seven different salads you can make. These are my recipes.
No, no. NASCAR and the Art of Revenge? Okay. You got my attention.
Use your signal, you cow!
When you're stuck in traffic, it's easy to lose your temper. Sometimes. We encounter other drivers so insanely idiotic that they make us question who decided to give them a license. Driving this poorly should be a crime. Sometimes it is, and the problem elegantly solves itself, but most of the time,
I'm gonna quickly check on my puppy, I'll be right back.
The idiot just gets away scot-free. Not content with the unfairness of it all, a few of us will try to take justice into our own hands, often with less than fortunate results. Before you plan an act of road retribution, you may want to seek out wisdom from the experts.
Boy, Brian Vickers, Dale Earnhardt Jr., that ain't gonna work, boys!
Motorsports feature the most talented drivers in the world, but they still succumb to the same emotions as the rest of us. With potentially millions of dollars on the line, patience on the racetrack runs very thin. Auto racing provides a unique opportunity for drivers to destroy each other's vehicles without any legal or financial repercussions. In series like NASCAR, the cars are durable enough to dish out some serious punishment without jeopardizing themselves. Most racing accidents are just that, accidents. But in NASCAR, a few wrecks are not just intentional, but premeditated. On track, the best drivers are just as skilled at retaliation as they are at racing. Revenge in NASCAR comes in many forms, some more elegant than others.
Well, rule number one of stock car racing is learn how to wreck someone without wrecking yourself.
The most proficient retaliators are discreet enough to make you think twice over whether or not it was even on purpose. But by far the most entertaining revenge is the opposite of discreet. In this video, I'm going to talk about seven cases of revenge so outrageously blatant that nobody could see it as anything other than pure, unadulterated retribution.
Okay.
Our first tale comes from the winding turns of Sonoma, California, one of the few road courses on the NASCAR schedule. These types of tracks give NASCAR drivers the opportunity to do something they rarely ever get to do, turn right.
Rewind!
And Sonoma's most eventful right
turn, it blew their mind.
Without a doubt, turn 11, a tight hairpin that forces drivers to decelerate from 120 to 40 miles per hour in just a few seconds. In one race, two drivers are about to get very familiar with turn 11 and each other. It's lap 37 of the 2011 Toyota Save Mart 350.
Okay.
Tony Stewart has a fast car, but he's stuck back in traffic. Tony's getting a bit frustrated with Brian Vickers, who refuses to give up his position. By the time they reach turn 11, Tony has had enough and dumps him.
Oh, he locked
him. Oh, got him.
During this time, Tony Stewart is one of the most formidable and aggressive drivers in the sport. If you raced him the wrong way, he would not hesitate to take you out of contention. Over the years, dozens of drivers have fallen prey to Stewart's retaliation, and for a moment, Vickers looked to be yet another victim. The race continues and Tony works his way through the pack. By lap 85, he's cruising to a top 5 finish when the broadcast cuts to commercial. When they come back, Tony Stewart has been sent to the Shadow Realm. It took Brian Vickers more than 50 laps to get back to Stewart, and when he did, he sure made the most of it. Vickers hooked Tony at the precise hit and angle to strand him on the tire barrier, knocking him out of the race entirely. A well-orchestrated act of payback, but one that would ultimately prove inconsequential in the grand scheme of things. Vickers may have won the battle that day, but it wouldn't stop Tony Stewart from eventually winning his third and final cup championship that season. At the very least, he didn't wreck anyone else for a while after this. They say that revenge is a dish best served cold, and in NASCAR, some drivers prefer to bite
hell yeah
before dishing out their payback.
Jimmy Johnson gets turned right in the
NASCAR crashes are insane.
He's not waiting to get in the ambulance, I don't think.
I think he's waiting to wave to his favorite driver right now.
Let's see.
In the 2000s, Robbie Gordon was possibly the only NASCAR driver more aggressive than Tony Stewart. Robbie was the racing embodiment of chaos. His decisions on the racetrack seemed to be governed entirely by impulse. He would do things on the track that seemed completely pointless to anyone.
How is this like a sport? It seems so impossibly dangerous.
One else but
what's up, Austin Show?
This is just what drives me crazy. Robbie Gordon is worried about a lap car, and he lets Tony Stewart take the lead.
These loose cannon antics made him the most entertaining driver to watch.
He was
the driver to boldly go where no other driver had gone before.
Robbie Gordon.
Die 940, thank you.
He's going to win the Dodge Save Mart 350.
Robbie Gordon was most well known as one of NASCAR's best road course racers, but his most bombastic moments would come at the Magic Mile in New Hampshire. In 2001, Robbie would infamously score his first ever NASCAR victory there by moving Jeff Gordon out of the way. In
the Pokemon soundtrack, fire.
Spun by Greg Biffle, and then hunt him back down like a heat-seeking missile, taking out two other championship contenders in the process. But
got
believe it or not, this wasn't even the best example of Robbie getting revenge at New Hampshire. So based on what we've seen so far, it's generally a bad idea to piss off Robbie Gordon on the racetrack. In the 2005 Sylvania 300.
Sylvania 300?
Did just that. By this season, Robbie Gordon had become fed up with answering to any team owner above him, so he opened up his own team.
Nice.
He ran the 2005 campaign as NASCAR's only owner driver. Financing your own race team comes with a lot of autonomy, but at the cost of a lot of, well, money. Any on-track mishaps would now
be
directly out of Robbie's own pocket. Considering his track record at that point, it was a pretty risky spot to be in. So how did Robbie do in his first year as his own boss? Pretty awful. By September, he has only one top 10 and has failed to qualify for four races. He's sitting a dreadful 36th in points, but he has a pretty decent
in the Jim Beam car.
That is until, while under caution, Michael Waltrip hooks him into the wall and totals his car. Needless to say, Robbie Gordon is not happy.
About the 15, then he said, NASCAR, I hope you're listening. I will pay Michael Waltrip back.
Holy shit, he ran out into the fucking traffic?
...against Michael, but after many months of inaction, everyone has pretty much forgotten about it. The following July, the Cup Series returns to New Hampshire. In 2006, Waltrip had become the co-owner of his own racing team, and just like Robbie the year before, he was struggling. Late in the race, Michael finds himself lined up behind who else but Robbie Gordon.
Nice.
Everyone else may have forgotten what happened the year prior, but Robbie sure hasn't.
Our guy's trying to come back.
Menards.
How did that happen? He's crashed back there and broken the radio.
Robbie Gordon didn't have many victories in his NASCAR career, but when he did win, he made sure to do it in a way that was unmistakably his. Drivers like Robbie are all but extinct in NASCAR today. But back in the day, it was common to see lots of drivers march to the beat of their own drum. If you were looking for a driver to inspire excitement, then perhaps you'd find it in Mr. Excitement, Jimmy Spencer.
It's gonna be a drag race to the checkered flag.
NASCAR, bro. It's crazy how big this sport is.
Jimmy Spencer would get into a litany of fights and altercations over the course of his career, but none was more heated than his feud with Kurt Busch. At the turn of the millennium, Kurt Busch was one of the fastest rising talents in the sport. In 2001, he was promoted to a full-time cup ride at just the age of 22. In his rookie season as NASCAR's...
Is this a MIDI version of I'm Bad?
...phenom, Kurt Busch got rocked. He finished 27th in points with 7 DNFs, and his biggest highlight of the year was being the last guy Dale Earnhardt ever flipped off. It's tough being a rookie at NASCAR's highest level, a lesson Kurt learned in the 2001 Phoenix race where he got turned by Jimmy Spencer in front of the entire field. Welcome to the big leagues, kid. At this point in time, Jimmy Spencer is in the opposite position of Kurt Busch. He's in the twilight of his career and his best days are long behind him. But in the 2002 Foods...
I go to church every goddamn Sunday!
Jimmy Spencer has the opportunity to do something he hasn't done in nearly 8 years. Win a Cup Series race. He's running second with just 60 laps to go and reeling in the leader. The only problem is that the driver running first is the same guy Jimmy Spencer wrecked just 5 months earlier.
Oh.
Of course, Kurt doesn't cut Jimmy any slack.
Oh, he hit him. Busch got under him and muscled Jimmy Spencer. You don't see that often. Now, Kurt Busch is a first-time Winston Cup winner at Bristol.
On this day, youth prevails over experience. After the race, however, Spencer ominously warns that the young driver still has much to learn.
There's a lot of things you can and can't do, and one thing you can't do is just beat and bang with people. And some guys have to learn. They just have to learn the hard way.
Oh, boy.
Later at Indianapolis, Spencer punted Busch at over 180 miles per hour.
Oh, shit.
Kurt is absolutely livid and trashes Spencer in the post-wreck interview.
We spun and that put us in a bad position back there with the decrepit old has-beens, I guess.
The feud continues to escalate until it reaches a boiling point in the next year's race at Michigan. Kurt swerves into Spencer trying to cut down one of his tires. After the race, Spencer reportedly marched over to Kurt's car and punched him in the face.
Jimmy got out of the car, approached Kurt Busch, and actually punched Kurt Busch.
Kurt left with a bloody nose and a chipped tooth, prompting NASCAR to suspend Jimmy Spencer for the next race. Now, at this point, it's important to recall that Jimmy Spencer has thus far demolished two of Kurt's race cars and his face, and the fans love him for it. The next race,
and the crowd goes wild.
...is littered with free Jimmy Spencer signs, and Mr. Excitement is arguably the most popular he's ever been. Sometimes a NASCAR feud represents more than just a simple disagreement between drivers. Kurt Busch and Jimmy Spencer symbolized a clash of generations in a changing sport. In the eyes of many fans at the time, Kurt Busch embodied a new wave of prima donna drivers who lacked the struggle and grit of seasoned veterans like Jimmy Spencer.
I mean, what happened last week was an assault after the race, and what had happened leading up to that in the past was I've got two wrecked race cars out of it, and I don't respect Jimmy Spencer.
Back in the day, drivers would settle disputes among themselves interference from the sanctioning body. Many felt that NASCAR was babying down the sport to conform to a more mainstream image. Too bad for them, NASCAR was entering a new age, whether they were ready or not. Just 1 year afterwards, Kurt Busch would sit atop the sport as champion. Not long after that, Jimmy Spencer would retire and find a new home on the Speed Channel. While Kurt got the best of him in their time as competitors, Jimmy Spencer always finds a way to have the last laugh.
It's time for Kurt Busch Radio Sweetheart!
Despite starting off as polar opposite rivals, Kurt Busch and Jimmy Spencer didn't end up being so different after all. NASCAR has always changed.
That is so great.
Cry as you might, you can't stop the future.
Okay, I'm done watching this. This was great. I'm done watching NASCAR videos, though. I'm going to hit up Jack and see if it's time. Oh, yeah, baby. Jack? Yeah, Jack Courage Dunlop, baby.
I'm a stud. I'm ballsy. I don't take no shit from anyone.
Kurt Busch testified in court that his ex-wife was a trained assassin. Not a joke.
Interesting. I've been playing a lot of Banners of Ruin. That game is sick. Do I not have Fall Guys installed right now? Is it on the Epic Launcher? Bop, 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 ba-da-da-da, bop. All right, hell yeah. So I said this earlier, but I'll restate it. I'm helping Jack Courage Dunlop get to 100 straight, not straight, but 100 Fall Guys crowns in a very short period of time. Why is my Epic launcher all fucked up? Hold on. I'm just going to download it on Steam. Fuck the Epic launcher, bro. What's his crown count at the moment? Let me see. Let me take a look. Courage. 100 Fall Guys crowns. Part one.
Nice.
Let's go. Let's go.
I don't know where he is right now.
Do you have music on? Or are you playing your...
Looks like he's in between. Fuck Epic? Yeah, for real, for real. Do. Small F? Yeah, I'm downloading a game. Beep. No, guys, it's okay. It's effing because I'm downloading a game. Mia Khalifa! This is internet in Los Angeles can get. The fastest internet available in Los Angeles.